So our next speaker is Segev Elazar-Mittleman, who is going to be speaking to us about enumeration and property-based testing.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm Segev Elazar-Mittleman. I'm here to tell you about our paper, Don't Go Down the Rabbit Hole, Reprioritizing Enumeration for Property-Based Testing. So property-based testing, heard a lot about it, well-known, well-loved. What really goes into it? Well, you got property specification, and then to add to that, you have to come up with some form of input generation. And not written here, but you can also do shrinking if you want. Okay, here's an example of a specified property. Let's say we're talking about some version of the lambda calculus with some typing rules, et cetera, et cetera. We have preservation here, a function from a term to the booleans, and what it says is, supposing that we have some term e that's well-typed, if it is well-typed, then its type will be maintained after a single execution step. So let me just walk you through the order of this talk. First things first, I'm going to set up the precondition problem for random generation. I'm going to explain how currently, black box random generation doesn't really solve that too easily with automatic methods, but that we can alternatively use lazy enumeration to fix it. Unfortunately, that'll hit an issue. It'll create something called a structural rabbit hole that we'll have to deal with. The remainder of the talk will show you how we attempted to solve these structural rabbit holes and maintain diversity in our search strategy. And then we evaluate on System F. So there are two main approaches to generation. You have randomness and you have enumeration. Starting with randomness. How do we do it? Well, let's first lay out a very simple lambda calculus. We have abstractions, applications, variables, and constants. Notably, we have a nat, which let's just treat as a type synonym for integers, under variables here. Why do we have that? Well, we're using de Bruijn indices. How do we randomly generate these terms? Well, in QuickCheck, all you have to do is create an instance of this arbitrary type class. And that means you have to create something of type gen term. How do you do that? Well, first things first, suppose that we already have an arbitrary instance. Suppose we already have an arbitrary generator for terms. Let's build it up recursively. Just to give a few examples, starting for the generator for constants, all you have to do, take the const constructor and map it over an arbitrary generator for integers, but that's just included in the library for quick check. For something more interesting, a recursive term, we have a generator for applications. We just use applicatives to take the app constructor and map it over two generators for terms. Notably, we assumed we had an arbitrary generator for terms. Stick these all together, and voila, you combining with the one-off combinator to take a uniform selection over all of these, you get something that you can probably just derive automatically. How great is this? Well, maybe it's really good, but it might have a little bit of an issue. In particular, with this precondition, well-typedness. The trouble with preconditions is that when you have a random generator that spits out a term that does not satisfy your precondition, you have to discard it. Let's talk about this problem with preconditions. With a very sparse precondition, where most of the terms that you generate will not satisfy the precondition, you're not going to get a lot of good coverage in a decent amount of time running the generator. Let's see if well-typedness suffers from this. So here, I'm extending our simple lambda calculus to System F, adding type-level lambdas and conditionals and some constants. And I'm going to compare the number of terms that are well-typed to ill-typed, for starting from those that take a single constructor to build. And on the right, those are ill-typed. Remember, we're using de Bruijn indices, and those are either free. The left is a free variable, and the right is just not a natural number. So two constructors, that's good, about parity. Three constructors, oh no, not so good anymore, but hopefully it doesn't get any worse. Here's four constructors, there's the well-typed terms. It's probably fine, probably. Oh God, not fine. And it only gets worse. here's how worse it gets. In fact, if you take the ratio of ill-typed to well-typed terms by constructor count, you get a beautiful exponential 2 to the n. Ooh, wonderful. So you got to ask yourself, do you feel lucky? Do you? I don't. So maybe there's another way. Maybe we can create a generator that comes up with only well-typed terms. That's groovy. People dig it. People have done it. It's not really easy, though. Not something you really want to do if you don't want to get distracted for a bit. Here's three papers that do it for simply typed lambda calculus, system F, and simply typed lambda calculus with effects. But the trouble is, for preconditions like well-typedness, and there are way more complicated preconditions, it takes a lot of time and effort to come up with an appropriate random generator that really satisfies it. Maybe there's another way. And there is. Enumerations, hip and with it. If it's small, do it all. That is the motto. So the idea for enumeration generation is that all we're going to do is list out all of the values of our data type from small to big, try them out one by one, see what comes out. If we find a violation of our property, hallelujah. How do we do it, though? Because, we know about enums, but how do you enumerate infinite types? Very simple. Here is an enumerator for our term type. You can see that it mirrors very closely the simple automated generator for a random generator. And what does it do? Here is an example of the start of enumeration of the type of lists of integers. See, we start with the empty list, and then we grow to bigger and bigger lists that take either higher valued integers or more or longer lists. And the idea is, if you start small, you'll never miss a small bug.
Is this just enumerating well-typed terms or all terms?
All terms for now. Okay. That was not enumerating terms, though. That was lists. So does this enumeration fix the precondition problem? No. Well, maybe there's another brand of enumeration we could use. In fact, laziness coming into the picture saves the day, or does it? Here is a partial term. We have a type level lambda, and then an if, and then it has a weird little guard that has a variable that has a negative index. That's ill-typed. We'll come back to that in a second. Both other leaves of this term are undefined. And if you have undefined leaves, well, then you can fill those in with whatever things you want. And here's a couple fulfilled examples, concrete terms, that you can generate from this partial term. We can think of these partial terms as defining sort of an index into a subspace of terms. And in a lazy language like Haskell, if your precondition is lazily evaluated, then you can apply your precondition to a partial term, and maybe you'll get an actual output, if it doesn't care about the undefined portions. Now, this cool little thing, which I didn't come up with, but smart people did, we see that if your term can falsify your precondition while having undefined portions, then the entire space of terms generated by that partial term will also violate your precondition. So if the partial fails, then the entire space fails, and therefore we can discard them all by just looking at a single example. The library lazy search puts this into implementation, and it takes care of our precondition problem. Woo, very nice, by just wiping out discarding all isomorphically failing terms together as one. Here is a bunch of isomorphically ill-typed terms. All of them are just completions of the example that I gave you before. And all of them can be thrown out and discarded by just testing the first one. So do we have a success yet? Unfortunately, no. So while we can avoid enumerating and trying out all of the ill-typed terms, because we discard them all at once, there's these things called that we term rabbit holes, which are the chunks of very similar terms, which are contiguous in the enumeration, that are well-typed, and therefore must be ran, each and every one of them. And this is a real chunk of terms that I took out of the enumeration. And you can see how they're all testing pretty much the same behavior, because they're all practically the same structure. That's not very good. We want to have a diverse range of behavior being tested. Testing rabbit holes exhaustively is unproductive. How do we avoid staying in these rabbit holes? Well, we're going to try fighting fire with fire. We're going to try using the rabbit holes to fight the rabbit holes. How do we do this? Well, the general strategy is as such. First, we're going to split up our entire input space into smaller subspaces, smaller rabbit holes, which are defined by those prefixes, by those term prefixes, partial terms. We're going to select them one by one, test terms only of that form until some timeout, and then keep looping until we find a counterexample. How do we do this? Well, let's start with the left. How do we generate a structurally similar subspace? OK. Well, here's a data type that's going to help us out. Index is just a data type that contains very suggestive names, which are the labels of the constructors of our term data type. And we're going to call a pattern a list of these indices. These patterns are going to represent similar subspaces. OK. Here's an example pattern, app prime, abs prime. And one of the partial terms, and therefore subspaces, that it refers to is this one. We have app at the root, and then because we have app prime as the next portion of the pattern, we have app as its child, and then we have abs prime, so the child of that app needs to have an abs, and every other portion of that term is left undefined. See how it defines a path inside of the term. Now, that wasn't the only option. This pattern is associated with four different subspaces that are related. It's just choosing where do you put the apps and where do you put the abs. Which children do you choose? So, that's great. We split up our search space. But the trouble is there are a whole lot of subspaces that we've created. In fact, if you have V index constructors, then if you take a pattern of length, or fineness as we term it, F, then there are V to the F different subspaces that we'll have to explore. Ugh, not very good. Can we cut down this search space in a principled manner? I say yes. How do we do it? Well, first things first, we're going to bring in this technique called combinatorial coverage, which is traditionally applied to finite Boolean configurations and how you test those. So let's give an example with that. Naturally, the natural example, we're going to talk about testing a hydraulic switch box with all of the usual Boolean switches. We have front, back, left side, right side, pancake, seesaw, etc., all natural. Can we test all possible configurations switching these on and off? Well, you could, but it would take 2 to the 10 tests. That's a lot. And maybe we don't want to spend the entire afternoon doing that. So, can we do less? Can we scale down sensibly? Yeah, sure. Let's talk about combinatorial coverage to do so. So instead of testing every possible combination of all the different variables, what if we consider exhausting only two strength or three strength interactions, i.e., exhausting subsets of the variables? So here, we consider all of these pairs of the variables. And for each of these pairs, there are four possible evaluations of them. True, true, false, 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 true, and true, false. You could also group them by 3 and exhaust all triples. If you do that, then you need 8 tests per triple. That sounds worse. Luckily, because each T-strength interaction has V to the T possible evaluations. But luckily, we can combine them all and pack many interactions into a single test. Here is an example of a generated test for our hydraulic doohickey. Notice that we have circled in red, yellow, and green those same circles that we had on the box. And if you notice, there is for each one of these circled groups, you get a full, all 8 possible evaluations of that group. In fact, in general, you reduce your V to the N rows required down to V to the T log N to have combinatorial coverage if you have an interaction strength of 3, meaning you care about subsets of an interaction strength of T, meaning you care about subsets of size T. Okay, but that works on finite sets. Okay, how do we extend that to algebraic data types, which are quite infinite? Well, here's the idea. We're going to explore the space of subspaces in a principled fashion by combinatorially covering not the data type itself, but the constructor indices in the patterns that we chop the data space, the data type up with. Okay, here's an example of such a combinatorial covering array for patterns. Each row in this array, you can see, represents a sequence of indices and therefore is a pattern. And if you take, here we have strength 2, so if you look at any pair of depths inside this pattern, you will get every single combination of constructor indices. So to give you an example, the top row, abs prime, abs prime, app prime, app prime, is going to be associated with this pattern, where we have an abs, abs, app, and then an app as a path through this tree. Okay, so we can select a new subspace. How do we test terms only of that form until a timeout? Well, that's very simple. Let's just take it back to lazy search. Lazy search is very good at dealing with structural preconditions. And all we have to do, if we want to look at terms only of a certain form that match a structural precondition, i.e. this member pattern, all we have to do is just discard all terms that violate the pattern. Very simple. So here is an example on how this member function, which defines our precondition, our structural precondition, works on the app prime index. All we do is we pattern match and look for the app constructor. If it matches, then we take the remainder of the pattern and look for it in the children, either of the children of the app constructor. And it works the same for everything else. So we can now focus our search in the data type by simply conjoining our member pattern to our well-typedness precondition, and then running lazy search. Okay. But then how do you get the patterns? Very simple. We can rely on previously used tools. ACTS is the best thing that I know of for creating combinatorial coverage arrays. So we just make a call to ACTS to make a covering array with a given choice of fineness, i.e. the length of the pattern we choose, and the strength, which is what subset size we care about for exhausting. And then we have a list of patterns. Then all we do, we call firstM to run lazy search on each of these patterns until we find a counterexample. That's great, except for one small thing. Lazy search will run as long as it wants until it finds a counterexample. So all we have to do to fix that, to make sure we test all the patterns we care about, at a time limit. OK, how do we evaluate this technique? Well, we just apply it to System F. The property that we test is that parallel evaluation of System F matches big step evaluation. We use mutation testing, meaning we have 20 injected bugs that we get from the literature. And then our baseline that we test against is lazy search, time to failure for finding each of these 20 bugs. OK, what do we do? Well, what we do is we take three different strategies, three different choices of hyperparameters for our technique, and run them concurrently to try and find each of the counterexamples. The three strategies we do is we do shallow patterns with medium timeouts and low strength to do an overall shallow search for shallow bugs. We look for deeper bugs with deep patterns, long timeouts, and moderate strength. But that's going to skip some patterns because it doesn't have high enough strength. And then we do a high strength, moderately sized patterns, and short timeouts to blitz through all of the different possibilities of patterns, just in case. What do we get? Well, on the bottom here, we have listing all of the different mutants that we care about, all the different bugs that we're injecting. In blue, we have our baseline lazy search. And in orange, we have our technique. And you see, we have, in almost every single instance, we beat lazy search very well. In fact, we get up to a 20-fold speed up in bug finding, which is pretty sweet. You'll notice on the left-hand side, you can't see any bars. That's because those didn't take very long to find. On those, we take a little bit of a hit of efficiency. But those are bounded. They don't take more than a few seconds to find, which is well within the range that we bring our that we bring the difficult bugs down to. So we take a hit in efficiency in finding easy to find bugs, but we get efficient exploration of the search space. And that is the technique. Any questions?
Really fun talk. Thank you.
Thank you.
So when we wrote Do Judge a Test by Its Cover a while back,
yeah,
we ran into a problem where in normal combinatorial coverage, there are kind of principled ways to know the strength you'll need,
mm-hmm,
just based on statistics that folks have about the kinds of algorithms that they're testing. In this case, it's not really clear, or at least when we were doing it, wasn't clear what the interaction strength meant. And so it wasn't clear how far you might need to enumerate. Have y'all found anything more to that effect to kind of make a principled decision there?
Yeah, on interpreting what interaction strength really means here.
Yeah.
We have a rough understanding that it means something about it helps tease out deeper bugs. But it's sort of rough. We don't have it's future work to figure it out more concretely. But thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I enjoyed reading this paper, actually.
Thank you.
But I had a very pragmatic question. It's kind of annoying. We have to call out to an external tool to generate the coverage array.
Yeah.
Do you have any insights in how difficult that would be to just have like a pure Haskell implementation of it? That's the only thing that I thought, this is annoying.
Well, luckily, you asked if there is an easier way than calling out to an external tool. If you have the external tool on your system, then we actually have a very nice Haskell API into it, which we wrote.
Okay, but I still need some...
You do still need the external tool. You could come up with a Haskell implementation of a coverage array generator.
Oh, it will be difficult?
That tool has been developed for like decades, so there's a lot of effort being put into there. You could write something simple. You actually don't need that complex of one because... I mean, it doesn't have to be that efficient to come up with the arrays. That's like the smallest part of the testing time that you care about. So yeah, you can write one if you want. We just relied on them because we did like a little partnership with NIST, and they came up with that tool.
All right. Thank you.
So each term matches many different patterns.
Yes.
So turning that around, each term may appear in several different enumerations.
Mm-hmm.
You may be running the same tests many times. Do you know how often that happens? Is there a problem?
I can tell you that, so that is true. Yes, these patterns are a little bit, they overlap somewhat, quite a bit at times. And that might be an issue. We do have some inefficiencies in that, and we actually could have done a couple optimizations there. But we wanted to keep things simple for the user to deal with and keep it sort of uniform. And as a result, I mean, we still have very good performance. We could have better performance, but that's something that we can consider for the future.
So this is a bit of an abstract question related to the T-strength thing. Do you think if you had like an upper bound of the Kolmogorov complexity of the program you're testing, and then using the T-strength interactions, get like a lower bound of all the behavior mm-hmm, the program that you've seen, and then if like the lower bound is bigger than the upper bound, you've kind of seen all the possible kind of interesting behavior, and then kind of get a proof that you've seen everything you wanted to see, or you've seen a good amount of what you wanted to see. Do you think that'd be possible?
I think that's a very rad idea. maybe I'm not sure, but that's definitely something to try. Thank you.
Thanks.
You have any other questions? We do.
Just related to the patterns or terms matching multiple patterns.
Yeah.
So another option that you could have done would be to have the patterns index which direction the pattern continues on for the branching terms. And I was just wondering if there is some kind of trade-off there, or why you decided to make them more generic just on the constructors.
In the presentation, I showed them just generically based on the constructors. But it's actually even, you can even do that generically based on the constructors. Just create one pattern for each direction, for each child it could go down, and then you can sort of simplify it, and therefore limit it to one subspace per pattern. And we did that actually. That's one of the strategies we used in the evaluation. And it helps. Sometimes.
All right, with that, let's thank our speaker one more time.